night about a quarter past six, there's a fella I see on TV. He's tall and he's lean and he dresses real keen and he acts like he's talking to me. He tells me the temp and the dew point and such and how long this weather will last. And he acts like he knows what he's talking about, so there's something I've just got to ask. Well, please, Tom Peterson, you got to try to make it rain. Please, Tom Peterson, you got to try to ease my pain. No more hot, dry winds, oh please. Cool, wet weather sets mind at ease, so please, Tom Peterson, you got to try to make it rain. I have no doubt, but there's one thing I wish he'd explain. When he points out the clouds and the fronts on the map, how's come I never get any rain? Now since I'm a farmer and can't raise a crop, when fall comes I'll be sure to pay. It rains to the south and it rains to the north, but I'll bet Tom gets paid anyway. Please, Tom Peterson, you got to try to make it rain. Oh, please, Tom Peterson, you got to try to ease my pain. No more hot, dry winds, oh, please. Cool, wet weather sets my mind at ease. Oh, please, Tom Peterson, you got to try to make it rain.
That song was written by a Siouxland farmer during the drought years of the late 80s, but it tells us something about how Siouxlanders felt about Channel 9's Tom Peterson, who, of course, passed away Sunday. Good evening again. Thanks for joining us. Tonight, in the next half hour, we're going to hear from just a few of Tom's many friends who will relate their experiences. Tom's life can't be placed into a half-hour television program, and we won't try to. But we are attempting to bring just a little bit of that vibrant life that he shared with us. It's been just two whole days since Tom was killed, and yet the outpouring of sympathy and support has overwhelmed us. That's gratifying to Tom's family and those of us who were his friends and co-workers here at Channel 9. So sit back as we remember Tom Peterson. Tom began his career at Channel 9 in March of 1977. That's just about the time that Ray Cole started here in the business office. Now, Ray Cole is vice president and general manager of KCAU.
When you think back to March 1977, what do you recall in that time that you were new to the station and he was new to the station?
Well, at that time, I was still a part-time employee. I joined the staff at KCAU as a college intern from Briarcliff. And upon graduation that spring, I went to work here full-time in June of that year. Tom had started in March, and Greg used to join the staff here that spring as well. So I look back at that time, and I wasn't Tom's boss then. I was a fellow employee. And I got to know him first in that capacity and just as a friend. And as I've said to a lot of people in the last few days, Tom, the Tom I knew then is the Tom that I knew up until his passing this past weekend, as someone who was very, very upbeat, someone who's very positive about life, someone who I'm confident jumped out of bed every morning and didn't crawl out because he couldn't wait to go out and see what fun he could have in his world that given day.
And he really did have fun on the air, didn't he?
Oh, he did. I've used words this week to describe him, whimsical, unflappable, now referring to him as his boss of the last several years, at times frustrating, because Tom was truly someone who was a bit of a free spirit, but that's what made him so special and so unique. And he truly had his own things that he wanted to accomplish in his life, and even though that life was taken away at a tragically early age, I think he accomplished most of what he set out to accomplish. He forged many friendships. He was a very caring, compassionate member of his family. My regard for Tom reached its zenith when I saw how he cared for his mother and her in the last years of her life. He talked a great deal about his two sisters. When his nephew Jeff was involved in another serious car accident a few years ago, Tom took that very hard, but I don't think the other members of his family maybe necessarily knew how that impacted him. And I also know that he has been there for that nephew in his recuperating years and months since then in a very special way, and has really been, he was really his nephew's hero as he's tried to overcome the results of that accident. So,
one of the things that I remember about Tom when I first came to the station was his involvement in the heavy hoopers and heavy hitters. He really seemed to enjoy that aspect too.
Yeah, he was the heart and soul of our team, and he would arrange those benefit basketball and softball games. And a quick anecdote is, I remember one of our early games. We played a benefit in Storm Lake, and at that time, and I remember we met you there.
That was my first game.
Your first game. And we went to Storm Lake by the way of Kingsley, which was my hometown, and our family still owned a grocery store there at that time. And even though the store was closed on this Sunday, I had a key to the family business and thought we would just stop in there and I told people, hey, just go in and pick up a few things and it's on me. I don't think our family business had ever been looted the way it was that Sunday under Tom's leadership. I couldn't wait to put the lock back on the door and get back on the road to Storm Lake.
He was really an ambassador for the station as well, not just with heavy hitters, but in all aspects of the community, wasn't he?
Yeah, the cards and letters we've received and have been receiving have been truly extraordinary from people, and that's what really comes out. He touched people in so many ways that extended and really transcended what he did for KCAU on the air here. Some of the more obvious ones, like the muscular dystrophy telethon, Drums Across America, that he was the voice of for all of the past 16 years. That event will never be the same, I don't think. We were asked in this business to be involved with a lot of causes where money is raised, whether it's a walk-a-thon, a ride-a-thon, a sing-a-thon, who knows. I don't think there's very many of those that Tom didn't share at one point. But beyond that, what I'm getting from, and I'm sure you are too, Greg, are hearing from a lot of people, is the way he connected with people on a very private, personal basis. Whether they could have been strangers on the street, but if you met Tom even once, you were no longer a stranger to him. He treated people as if he had known them a very long time. And again, it went back to the heart of it. It goes back to the heart of his personality, where he truly cared about people and couldn't make enough friends.
It's a great lasting legacy.
It is, truly.
Tom came to television from radio. It was an easy transition for him. He took to the tube, and the tube took to him. But he was also quick to point out that he only reported the weather forecast. He did not make it up. Over the years, he gained a great understanding of weather. Unfortunately, he and I never sat down to record his thoughts on weather and the way he broke into TV. But fortunately, Sioux City and Linda Harchi did. Here's some segments of an interview she did as a college student in 1991 at Briarcliff College.
I really don't have any special abilities. What I think you get after 15 years is just repetition. You do it so often, and you deal with one subject so much that some things finally sink in. And so, yeah, in a sense, you go outside and you know when you feel the air, and you know it's too cool to produce tornadoes, that you're not going to worry about it in the area that you're in.
Are you usually right on target with your weather forecast?
Oh.
Have you made any gross errors in the forecast?
Have you ever seen any gross errors? Some would say just by arriving it's a gross error. No, I don't think that weather is that accurate yet. I think there are lots of gross errors. It's a case of the science of weather doing the best it can. And the best it can do is for the immediate future, for the immediate 6 hours, doggone it, they're good. For the immediate 12 hours, they're pretty good. for the next 18 hours, the accuracy, as it were, falls off a little bit. 24 hours falls off a little bit more. By the time you talk about the next 3 months, it's just anybody's guess.
What prompted you to get into broadcasting then and weather forecasting?
It was kind of by default. All through college, the last couple of years in high school, and all through college, I had worked in radio as a part-time job. A lot of other guys were sacking groceries and doing things, and I was working at radio stations because when I was in high school, this other kid and I had a tape recorder, and we had this great idea. Let's go to the radio stations, take the tape recorder, and say, we'll do interviews of high school ball players that you could play at halftime. If your play-by-play guys would like a break. Well, we went to KM&S, and they said, no, we've got Gene Sherman. Oh, so you do. And Gene has that handled. Thanks, boys. And we went to KSEJ, and they said, well, that's a very enterprising idea, young men. Maybe we can do that. And we went out to a place called KDVR, which was out on Correctionville Road in Sioux City. And it was at 97.9. And it was owned by a family, very nice bunch of people, and they programmed it with classical music, with jazz, with country, everything. And they said, no, we don't do ball games, but we need afternoon announcers. You've got a nice voice. Would you like to come out and be an announcer?
Great.
Literally walking into the station. And, you know, would you like to be on the radio was just...
For a high school student, that was wonderful.
I'd love to. I don't care what kind of station it is. And I got a job there, and then KSCJ called, and they said, we'll give you a try, boys. Would you like to do it? So we went out, and we did high school interviews. We did interviews with ball players and came back up, and KSCJ played them at intermission, or at halftime. And it was a great deal for us. And starting then, I had part-time jobs all through college.
How did you get started using pointers?
The very first day that I ever did the weather. Let me go back. I knew everybody at the station, or most of the people at the station, before I started working there. And so I was going to do a week of the noon weather before I started doing the 6 and 10. And the very first day, the very first noon, the people in the newsroom, the studio was in the newsroom, and as you did the weather, people were sitting around you and kind of watching. And they were all trying to give me a hard time and get me nervous before the first one. So they were saying things like, are you nervous? A lot of people get real sweaty. A lot of people really have a problem with this and lose their train of thought. Their mouth dries up. Are you nervous yet? No.
Sounds like good friends.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, guys. No, I'm not. So to show them that I wasn't nervous, they turned to me and they said, here's Tom Peterson, and he's doing weather this week. Lee Dennis is... gone on to other things, and Tom, go ahead. So I started doing the weather. And I was using a pen. I was pointing out what the weather was on the weather map, and we had a commercial in the middle of the weather, and the point was to say, we'll be back with the forecast right after this, meaning the commercials. And I said, we'll be back with the forecast right after this, meaning the commercials, and did this to show them in the newsroom.
That you were here.
She didn't get to me. You know, I can take this. And didn't think anything of that. And came back, did the forecast, and, you know, they, at the end of it, when we were off camera, said, yeah, hot shot, yeah, that was fine. So I'd passed their little test of fire. We kept track of phone calls down at the station. People called in saying the usual, who's the new guy, where's the old guy? I like the new guy, I don't like the new guy. People offer their opinions a lot, and that's fine. There was at least one call that said, that was real neat the way he flipped his pen and caught it. And I had to think back, what was all that? So the next day, I did that, said we'll be back with the forecast for the person who called, rather than for anybody in the newsroom. And a couple of more people called. So that was real neat the way he flipped his pen and caught it without looking at it. I just trapped it there. That's an illegal trap in the pointer biz. And I kept doing it, and people kept mentioning, well, you're doing all right in weather, but that's real neat how you flip the pen. So I thought, well, if people like that, that's great. And then people started giving me pens, and here, why don't you use my pen? That's from Joe Blow Insurance Company, you know. Mm-hmm. Well, I can say it's from Joe Blow of Sioux City. I can't say it's from Joe Blow Insurance Company, but I thought, this is a great deal, because I'm getting a lot of free pens, and I can use pens. And then I went to a game, I think the very first one was actually a snowflake. Somebody said, here, we carved this snowflake out of wood, and I used that. But then I went to a game, a benefit basketball game, and they said, we noticed you flip pencils. Here, flip this. And they gave me a pencil that was a 4x4 whittled down in that long. Flip this, sucker.
Did you flip it?
Yeah. And as soon as I flipped it, the floodgates just opened and everything pointy came out of the woodwork. And I've been doing them ever since.
We thank Linda Hartsey for that interview. Tom was active, of course, in many organizations and many causes. One that had special meaning for him was Riverside School in Sioux City. It was a school that educated mentally challenged students. Dr. Norm Ashby was principal at that school.
Dr. Ashby, tell us the association that you recall between Tom Peterson and Riverside School.
Mm-hmm. I was principal at Riverside School, and Tom came to the school to visit with the students and spent time with them, and also he was the MC for the very special Arts Festival, which was held annually. And his activities at the community theater provided opportunities for our students to go down and participate in work study. And they especially enjoyed the time when Tom was there, because he would socialize with them and spend time with them.
Tell us about how the students interacted with Tom.
It was a they recognized Tom as a personality, and they enjoyed visiting with him, and he spent a generous amount of time with the students. He would visit the classrooms and talk with and kid with the students in the various classes.
What did it mean, do you think, to the students to have that sort of interaction with him?
It was very meaningful to them, because they recognized him as a television personality, and they really enjoyed that.
Tell us about the kids that are educated there that Tom would visit. Mm-hmm.
These were the mentally disabled students, and a good share of them were rather severe. But the older, most able students did recognize him and were able to visit with him.
Okay. Tell us about that art fair. What kinds of things went on there, and what would Tom do in regards to that?
Okay, this was an annual event. And students from special education classes throughout the district who had come to Riverside during that time and put on performances, display artwork, and it was a kind of a holiday, festive kind of a day.
Okay. And again, that was a special day for these students, and for Tom, I would imagine, too. Did he ever talk about what it did for him coming out there?
Oh, yes, he seemed to really enjoyed it. He was very generous with his time, and spent a considerable amount of the day visiting with the students, with the groups in the building.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ashby.
Tom's life, to a large degree, as you've seen, was played out on a stage. He enjoyed being on the air, on radio and television, but the theater stage had a very strong attraction for him. Dr. Greg Galloway, a former theater board vice president, remembers.
Dr. Galloway, tell us in broad strokes what the impact was that Tom Peterson had on the theater during the time that you have worked with him, the time you've been familiar with the theater.
Well, I've known Tom with the theater for probably 14 years, and he was the driving force for the development of the theater and the continual, I guess, broad-based development and its relationship to the community. Specifically, the things he did best were to incorporate people from all walks of the community to give something to the community theater, just like he did. At different points in time, there were different ones of us, some with theater background, some with business, some with the community, other aspects, but he tried to bring them all together to develop the community theater.
He seemed to us, anyway, to have his heart stuck in the community theater. He was involved in many other things, but the theater was indeed special to him. Would you agree with that?
I would agree with that entirely. I think that was his first labor of love in our community, was the community theater.
How did that show in, you've already described the kind of impact, but in perhaps, were there small ways that you could tell that he felt special about that?
Well, I think Tom was, his first love, I think, was people. And the community theater was a place where you could go and act yourself or to do things that you loved. And you added that with a heart that was not selfish, and the community theater was a natural for him. Well, I think when he did The Weather, when he did the introduction to the community theater day in and day out, our community was his theater. And so I think it was a natural that he liked to be where people could be performed. Not from a selfish reason or anything like that. He felt comfortable with his skills, and he felt comfortable with his personality to give that to the community. And I think that's why he was with the community theater. I think that's why he would do anything for anybody, for the development of children, for the community, for the fairs, wherever you asked. I think that was Tom's medium, was theater and his great love of people.
Did he ever talk to you about his love for Sioux City? Because I think that was paramount in a lot of things in his life, and perhaps included the theater when he used to talk about the old Shore Acres Ballroom, now the community theater.
Right. Well, I've known Tom Wilson on a personal basis and professionally at the theater from the management side. And Tom has told me numerous times in different ways that he would never want to leave Sioux City. If he got another job offer, he wasn't going. The community theater, he would stay with it. I think there are a lot of things that people didn't know about Tom and the community theater, which speaks to his wanting to stay in our community and the pride in it. I know he gave up personally money. He would make private donations to the theater. I know that he would take a cut in salary to make the renovations occur at the same time he was giving more energy to the community theater. That's a rare personality. That's a rare giving person. And I don't think you'd do that unless you love the community you live in and the projects you're working on. Tom had a tremendous pride in our community, and he wanted to see it grow, and he wanted to see it happy too.
Do you ever know where that pride came from, where that seed comes from in a person to make him grow like Tom did?
Well, I think it occurs in all of us, and I think it occurred in Tom, and it's somewhat speculation. I think Tom felt comfortable in Sioux City. I think he identified with its values. I think he identified with his roots. And whenever we are comfortable with something as a person, I think we behave better. I think we like what we're doing better, and I think we express that. And I think that was in Tom's heart and feeling. I think Tom felt accepted in our community, and I think Tom liked our community.
I have perhaps not been surprised, but amazed at the outpouring of support from the community since his death. How do you think he'll be remembered, perhaps from the community theater angle, or perhaps just from a community-wide angle that you'll see?
Well, I think the community theater will do something in the next week or so to recognize Tom formally on a permanent basis at the community theater. Several ideas have been tossed around, dedicating the community theater to Tom, maybe dedicating and naming it after him, and also establishing a permanent foundation for the perpetuity for the community theater. I think all of those things will be talked about. Those of us who are around and will remain around will always remember Tom, though, for his contributions. So the living things will be with those of us who knew him, worked with him, practiced with him, and so forth. There will be other things physically that we can do for those in the future who didn't know Tom the way we did, that hopefully they can remember him or ask, who was that and what did he do? And we hope for that also.
Thank you, sir. We've been pleasantly surprised by the outpouring of sympathy at the news of Tom's death. On behalf of the entire staff at Channel 9, I'd like to thank all of you for your many acts of kindness. We leave off tonight with a piece prepared by our own Jeff Moreland, who worked closely with Tom on the Muscular Dystrophy Telethon. Good night, everybody.
Part of me just wants to tell you everything. One part just needs the quiet. And if I'm lonely here, I'm lonely here. And on the telephone, you offer reassurance. I will not take these things for granted. I will not take these things. How can I hold the part of me that only you can carry? Strength I haven't found. cold, and on the telephone you offer warm asylum. I'm listening, flowers in the garden, laughter in the hall, children in the park. I would not take these things for granted. I will not take these things for granted. I will not take these things for granted. I will not take these things anymore. Crawl inside the wine, feel something near me. To feel is accepting that it is lonely here, but not alone. And on the telephone you offer visions dancing. I'm listening, music in the bedroom, laughter in the hall, dive into the ocean, singing by the fire, running through the forest, standing in the wind, rolling canyons. I will not take these things for granted. I will not take these things for granted. I will not take these things for granted.
One of Siouxland's most well-known personalities has been killed. The Major Nine's Tom Peterson dies in a Minnesota car crash. Good evening and thanks for joining us. It's my sad task to tell you tonight of the death of longtime Channel 9 employee Tom Peterson. Greg Lund is here now with the story. Greg.
Thank you, Lori. We got the news this evening that Tom Peterson had lost his life in a car crash near Heron Lake, Minnesota. The accident happened about 3 o'clock this afternoon. Tom was traveling south on Highway 60 when he attempted to pass a snowplow. His car collided head-on with another vehicle that carried a mother, a father, and their four sons. They were all taken to a hospital in Minnesota. Three were treated and released. The two adults and one son are still hospitalized, but a state patrol officer told us tonight their injuries are not believed life-threatening. Tom was 45 years old at the time of his death. He was a Sioux City native, a graduate of Central High School, and he graduated from Morningside College in 1970. Tom was a Vietnam veteran. He served as a correspondent in that war, and he was the last American newsman out of Vietnam. He started here at Channel 9 in March of 1977, where he reported the 6 and 10 o'clock weather, a position he has held until his death. He was active in our muscular dystrophy telethon each year, heading up our recent Channel 9 efforts. He was also very, very active in the Siouxland community. His love of the theater led him to the general manager position at the Sioux City Community Theater. He desperately loved the theater. He visited countless schools to talk about the weather. He read to students and encouraged them to stay in school. Tom was always on duty. When severe weather struck, he was here. He liked to have fun, too. He made the weather fun for all of us, and we hope all of you. Senior citizens were a special favorite of Tom, and he spent countless hours with them. He was active in politics, environmental issues, and was a former president of the Sioux City Press Club and was active in journalistic affairs. Tom was a very valued colleague here at KCAU. I started here just a few months after Tom in 1977. He brought a real spark and wit to his work, qualities that touched us all. KCAU Vice President and General Manager Ray Cole said tonight that like any family that's lost someone close to them, KCAU's family is hurting tonight. Ray said, and we all agree with him, that we will miss the life and vitality that Tom brought to us personally just as much as his professional contribution. Ray went on to say that Tom connected with his audience in a very unique way. He had a tremendous personality and tremendous warmth. Lori, at this time, funeral services are pending, not set yet. Of course, when they are set, we'll bring it to the viewers here on Channel 9, because I know many of you want to express your condolences to his family, as we do tonight. Tom has two sisters, one in the Des Moines area, one in the Minneapolis area, and our thoughts and prayers are with them this evening. Lori.
That's a terrible story. Thank you, Greg. Another tragic story.
A head-on crash on a Minnesota highway takes the life of Channel 9's weather director, Tom Peterson. Tom is the only fatality in the two-vehicle crash that injured six other people. The people who knew and worked with Tom and who watched Tom are in mourning tonight. Good evening. Thanks for joining us this evening. Tom's death yesterday afternoon was shocking, not only to his co-workers and friends here at the Major 9, but also to countless viewers who invited him into their homes nearly every night, making him practically a member of their own families. Meanwhile, the investigation into the accident continued today by the Minnesota Highway Patrol. Jim Sear has more.
The crash happened just south of Heron Lake in southwestern Minnesota. Peterson was on his way back from visiting his sister in Minneapolis. Witnesses say that he was trying to pass a snowplow as he headed south on Highway 60. It wasn't snowing at the time, but the snow kicked up by the plow left no visibility. It's unlikely that he ever saw the other car until it was too late.
And because of the whiteout conditions caused by the snow plow, there was zero visibility, and he met the Suburban that was northeastbound in his traffic lane, and neither one of them had any time to react. It was just when they saw each other, it was too late, and that's when the impact happened.
The force of the impact completely smashed in the front of the car that Peterson bought recently. Investigators say that it was so strong, he probably died instantly. Five people in the car he collided with were injured, but none of the injuries appear to be life-threatening.
The father was transferred from Worthington Hospital to Sioux Valley Hospital. He suffered a bilateral broken jaw, lost several teeth. The mother had some broken ribs. She was held at the Worthington Hospital. And one of the boys had a broken femur. He was held at the Worthington Hospital. And the other three children were treated and released.
They were the kind of weather conditions that Peterson spent years warning people about, and ironically, in the end, contributed to his death. Jim Sear, Major 9 News, here in Lake, Minnesota.
Tom Peterson's life was chock full of people, love, work, play, emotion, and peace. It is impossible to characterize his 45 years, nearly 46 years, in a word, nor capture it in a few seconds. But it seemed to those of us on the outside a pretty wonderful life. Tom Peterson was a Siouxlander through and through. He was mugging for the camera from the start. His parents, Lloyd and May Peterson, welcomed Tom to the Peterson family in Sioux City in 1948. He joined two sisters, Carolyn and Robbie. It was off to Bryant School, where friends say the first inkling of Tom's effervescent personality shone through. He was a Cub Scout and rolled through Old North Junior High before arriving at the Castle on the Hill, which he conquered in 1966. After a bachelor's degree from Morningside College 4 years later, the draft caught up with him and it was off to the Army. Basic training in Missouri, more training in North Carolina. He also learned to fly while he was in the Army, a pastime that included some hair-raising moments for his passengers, including this reporter. Tom was sent to Vietnam as a Stars and Stripes correspondent. His experiences there were to shape the rest of his life. He was planning a return trip to Vietnam this summer. Back from the service, Tom returned to Sioux City and rekindled his interest in radio at KMNS. He took the moniker Captain America. From there, KCAU came calling with a weather proposition. The rest, they say, is history, including these pictures of early pen flips, which evolved into his trademark pointers.
I'm your reporter, Robin Leach. Tonight, we come to you from a ship that's first class all the way from Rio to Rockefeller Center.
Never a shrinking violet, Tom was an annual Press Club gridiron actor. His natural charm helped him with countless school kids. He was a welcome visitor at scores of Siouxland schools, mixing weather information with humor and a message to study hard and stay in school. He gave of himself to the community theater, too. It was where his heart lay, and he immersed himself in all theater activities.
Excited. This is the weather department.
Tom was an expert on Sioux City and, with his gift of gab, could talk forever. But he always had a warm spot in his heart for the muscular dystrophy telethon he hosted. His yearly devotion was just one measure of how he lived his wonderful life. We'll present a special salute to Tom Peterson tomorrow night at 6:30, right after the Major 9 News. One of Tom's first loves was acting and the theater. He was the president and general manager of the Sioux City Community Theater and was the driving force of its continued growth. He organized a $500,000 renovation project and was always standing at the door, ready to greet visitors with a handshake and a smile.
I think Tom's biggest contribution to the Sioux City Community Theater was the fact that he knew probably 95.5% of the people who came in the door by a first name. And he was able to greet everybody. He was probably one of the best schmoozers I've ever met in my entire life.
His vision was to have one of the finest theaters in the country, not only the state. And we've been to a number of theaters around the area, and we're well on our way.
The Sioux City's Community Theater's name may be changed to the Tom Peterson Theater. The board of directors will meet next week to make a decision on that. Tom also had a background in the military, serving as a correspondent in Vietnam for the military newspaper Stars and Stripes. When he returned to the States, Tom was active in veterans organizations. Greg Anderson and John Gallagher first met Tom when they joined Concerned Veterans of Siouxland. Both of them say that Tom was passionate about helping fellow Vietnam vets.
He was just a very, very special person. I can't remember him ever missing a meeting. We met weekly for months, and he always was there at the meetings. He would work as harder than anybody else, and he was a real inspiration to us.
Tom was just like it's hard to put it in words. He was a Vietnam vet, and it's just like a brotherhood type thing. I can't put it in words. You feel it.
Both Anderson and Gallagher say that Peterson was instrumental in bringing a portable replica of the Vietnam Veterans Wall, like the one in Washington, D.C., to Sioux City, where these pictures were taken in 1987. Tom's spirit and presence touched everybody around him, including those he worked with each day at the National Weather Service. Weather officials say Tom's professionalism and smile set him apart from other meteorologists and weather directors.
Tom had away with words. He would call and ask us, for instance, what was causing the weather on a particular day or something like that, and we could explain it to Tom, and just in a matter of very few minutes, he would be on TV repeating almost verbatim what we had told him about the weather.
Quinn says Tom's daily phone calls to the National Weather Service will be missed, but fondly remembered.
It's just been a pleasure knowing him. I feel grateful that I had the privilege of knowing Tom Peterson.
In Siouxland, Tom's giving and kindness were as far-reaching as his nightly weather forecast. Iowa Congressman Fred Grandy, a high school classmate of Tom's, acknowledged Tom's many contributions to the area.
Tom Peterson and I, as we say, usually glibly go way back, but Tom was normally the kind of guy that you could always count upon to host the telethon. The weatherman on Channel 9 and I went to high school together, have known one another ever since we were 8 or 9 years old. My wife and I just performed at his community theater about 2 months ago. He was a real booster for Sioux City and a very accomplished media professional and just a terrible loss to our community.
As Congressman Grandy said, he performed at the Sioux City Community Theater with his wife, Catherine Mann, a few months ago in the presentation, Love Letters. Well, at a time when the Sioux City Council would be celebrating the swearing-in of their new mayor, new council members expressed sadness over Tom's death.
One of the things I think that most people remember about Tom was his smile, because whenever he talked about Sioux City, he smiled.
After a moment dedicated to remembering Tom, new council members were sworn in along with Sioux City's new mayor, Bob Scott. Scott appointed Harry Kearns as mayor pro tem. After the ceremony, city leaders said Tom was a tremendous asset.
The thing that I always admired about Tom, he always smiled, particularly when he talked about Sioux City. And I said, we need more like him.
Guy, Tom and I probably did 7 or 8 things where we read books to kids together in the last 8 years, and we joked back and forth, and he was a great guy. What a loss to a community.
I'm sure Tom could have moved on and left this community, but I think it was his love for this community that kept him here, and we really appreciate that.
KSCJ Radio dedicated its open line morning talk show to Tom Peterson. Calls flooded KSCJ's studio line with callers who poured out their heartfelt support for Tom's friends and family. Show's producer says over 50 calls came into the newsroom, a record since he can remember. KCAU-TV General Manager Ray Cole and myself were guests on the show. We appreciate the kindness shown toward us today. Many of the callers were friends, calling in with anecdotes and memorable stories about Tom. Now, memorial services for Tom have been scheduled and have been finalized. Family visitation will be held Wednesday evening from 7 o'clock in the evening until 8:30 at the Sioux City Community Theater. That's on Riverside Boulevard in Sioux City. A memorial service will be held Thursday afternoon at 1 o'clock at Epley Auditorium. That's on the campus of Morningside College. Both observances are open to the public.
And so he made a mark, a very lasting mark on this community that I think will live on for many, many years.
That is KCAU General Manager Ray Cole talking about weathercaster Tom Peterson, who was killed in a traffic accident yesterday afternoon. Good evening, Sioux Land. I'm Larry Wentz. The 45-year-old Peterson died in a head-on collision near Heron Lake, Minnesota, yesterday afternoon. He was returning to Sioux City after visiting his sister in the Twin Cities. Tom Peterson touched the lives of many Siouxlanders through his work at KCAU Channel 9 and as general manager of the Sioux City Community Theater. Channel 4's John Grover has more on the impact that Tom had upon Siouxland and its residents.
Tom Peterson has been called the most recognizable face in Siouxland. For 17 years, he's been the weather director at KCAU Channel 9. His gimmick that quickly caught the attention of viewers was the pointers Peterson used to point to weather maps.
This is the other pointer. It is the Akron Westfield Westerners painted logo here. Isn't that a nice piece of work? Both of them came to us as we played basketball up there Saturday night. We played basketball with Spencer on Sunday. And we will show you the
it's past 10 o'clock. We return to this Monday morning edition of Open Line as we remember Tom Peterson this morning. Just an incredible shock to the community and the Channel 9 viewing area.
Monday morning, the entire radio program Open Line on KSCJ was devoted to Tom Peterson.
Let's go to Marvin, who's been waiting patiently to get on this morning's Open Line. Hi, Marvin. Good morning.
I knew Tom from the community theater, and when we moved to Sioux City... And
KTIV general manager Bill Turner called from Florida. Turner was the general manager at KCAU when Peterson was hired.
Some of the fond memories I also have of him, he was one of the few people, I think, who could imitate my voice. And that always gave everyone a kind of a smile on their face every time Tom cut up to do anything.
News anchor Greg Lund and KCAU general manager Ray Cole talked about their relationship with Peterson and the impact on the station and co-workers.
It's so difficult because we were trying to pull together a newscast last night where the lead story was the loss of one of our fellow employees. That's about as difficult a night as I ever want to go through again. I told Greg when he got off the air that he was a stronger man than I was. I could not have done what he did last night. I sat in our control room and I couldn't talk. And for him to do what he did...
This is Gwen.
At Channel 9, phones rang off the hook.
Oh, I believe they're going to be Wednesday at 1 o'clock and a memorial service is at Thursday at 1 o'clock at the Epley Auditorium.
This is Tom's home away from home, the Sioux City Community Theater. On top of his job at Channel 9, he was the general manager here at the theater for the last 10 years. Folks here say his presence will be greatly missed.
Such a gregarious individual, so full of life, and to have that job, you know, with the weather, and still have the opportunity to have a second job out here at the theater and do so many things, it would be impossible to replace him.
In Sioux City, John Grosvenor, Channel 4 News.
Former Mayor Jim Wharton took a moment to remember Tom Peterson before the silent prayer today's city council meeting. Wharton acknowledged the personal and professional contributions that Peterson made to the Siouxland area. He recalled the days that they worked together at KMNS Radio when Peterson was known as Captain America. Wharton said he'll be missed and expressed his condolences to Peterson's family and colleagues. Now, a visitation and memorial service for Tom have been scheduled. A visitation for family and friends is set for 7 p.m. Wednesday night. That visitation for family and friends again to be held at the Sioux City Community Theater, the time Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And a memorial service for Tom has been set for Thursday afternoon at 1 o'clock in Epley Auditorium on the campus of Morningside College. Again, that memorial service scheduled for 1 o'clock Thursday afternoon at Epley Auditorium on the Morningside campus. Tonight, those of us here at Channel 4 express our condolences to Tom's family, his friends, and co-workers at Channel 9. We were honored to know Tom, too, through his work with the Sioux City Press Club, the Press Club's annual Gridiron Fundraising Play, and the Community Theater. I can't begin to tell you how many times that Tom was able to sell me a raffle ticket during my short 3 years here in Siouxland. He will be missed, but certainly not forgotten.
You have to realize that Tom lived life on his terms. If there was one person that I can point to that I know that has lived life the way he wanted to live it, without all the encumbrances that the world presses upon us, it was Tom Peterson. He worked in television because he wanted to. His other great love was the theater. He could meld those two careers. But this is a guy who loved life, who, as we talked about, was never down, that I knew about, even on days when he had a right to be down over something. But he lived life on his terms, and I'm sure that, you know, his license plate was Cloud 9, and he's up there, and if there's a guy that got the most out of life, it was Tom Peterson.
Good night, everybody. Good night. Thank you.
A head-on car accident in Minnesota has claimed the life of Channel 9's longtime weather director, Tom Peterson. Good evening. Thanks for joining us. I'm Lori Furlong in for Greg Lund. We'll have more details on the accident in a moment. But first, we'd like to take a look back at the many accomplishments and contributions Tom gave to the community. Greg Lund has more.
Tom Peterson was a Siouxlander through life.
We'll present a special salute to Tom Peterson tomorrow night at 6:30 after the Major 9 news. Investigators say that it's unlikely that Tom suffered very much. The impact of the collision was so strong that he probably died instantly. The crash completely caved in the front of the car that Peterson purchased recently. State Patrol officials say that he tried to pass a snowplow and the visibility was so bad that he never saw the oncoming car. One of Tom's first loves was acting in the theater. He was the president and general manager of the Sioux City Community Theater and was the driving force of its continued growth. He organized a $500,000 renovation project and was always standing at the door ready to greet visitors with a handshake and a smile.
I think Tom's biggest contribution to the Sioux City Community Theater was the fact that he knew probably 95.5% of the people who came in the door by a first name. And he was able to greet everybody. He was probably one of the best schmoozers I've ever met in my entire life.
His vision was to have one of the finest theaters in the country, not only the state. And we've been to a number of theaters around the area, and we're well on our way.
The Sioux City Community Theater's name may be changed to the Tom Peterson Theater. The board of directors will be meeting next week to make a decision. Tom Peterson's background not only included television and theater, he also had a military career. Peterson served in the Vietnam War in the early 1970s. He then became active in veteran support groups. Brian Allen spoke with two Sioux City vets who were close friends of Tom's.
Greg Anderson and John Gallagher are in mourning this evening over the death of their close friend, Channel 9 weather director Tom Peterson. Both men first met Peterson when they joined Concerned Veterans of Siouxland, an organization comprised mainly of veterans of Vietnam, where Tom served as a war correspondent for the military newspaper Stars and Stripes.
He was a neat guy, a friendly guy. He remembered everybody's name. It was just incredible. He made it an effort or a passion to remember people because I think he knew how much that meant to people.
The first time I met Tom is just like we was good friends forever. He made you feel that way.
Both men say that Peterson was a very hard worker, one who went after any project with tenacity.
He would work as hard or harder than anybody else, and he was a real inspiration to us.
Most of us will remember Tom Peterson for his good-naturedness, the way he always had a smile on his face, and how his laugh would reverberate through the halls. But there was also a more serious side to Tom Peterson, and that side came out when he talked about his experiences in Vietnam.
In 1987, a replica of the Washington, D.C. Veterans Memorial Wall made a stop in Sioux City. Tom was very influential in bringing the monument here and was even the master of ceremonies.
He was definitely passionate about bringing the Vietnam Wall to Siouxland.
The pictures on the walls of the Vet Center chronicle images which stir painful memories in the minds of veterans. But for these two veterans, there's another painful memory, that of a great friend whose life tragically ended too soon. Brian Allen, Major 9 News, Sioux City.
Both Anderson and Gallagher say that Peterson will be remembered for his humor and kindness. At a time when the Sioux City Council would be celebrating the swearing-in of their new mayor, new council members expressed sadness over Tom's death.
I mean, it's very tough to be happy now. I mean, we're not happy, but we're trying to make it happy.
The king of the pointers, veteran KCAU-TV weatherman Tom Peterson, wouldn't have wanted it any other way. Family members say remembering the happiness that Tom brought to Siouxland is the only way to cope with the grief of his loss. Good evening. I'm Greg Lund. Thanks for joining us tonight. A memorial service has been planned for Tom Peterson, of course, who sat next to me at this desk for years. Tom was killed in a head-on car collision last Sunday in Minnesota. He'll be remembered partly for the thousands of pointers he used over the years during his forecast. Now today, Tom's sisters gave us a special look at the pointers and memories that he amassed over the years.
In Tom Peterson's world, just about anything qualified as a pointer. This is the room at his house where he stored a wide variety of items, that people sent him to use on the air.
Tom had been collecting the pointers for about 15 years, and over time they began to add up. In fact, there are thousands here in his home. So last year he decided to build a pointer room.
But the idea for using the pointers wasn't planned. It started during his first few days on the air in 1977 when he flipped a pencil in the air. Tom's sisters say the pointer concept took off from there.
The station started getting calls and they said, hey, we like your new weatherman. If he can flip a pencil, what else can he flip? And they started sending him things. Mm-hmm. And that's how all of this started.
But the pointer room isn't just limited to his weather instruments. There are also the reminders of his clever sense of humor that made him a Siouxland fixture.
There's a reef, and then in the center, he put in the center of the reef, he put a picture of Ben Franklin. So now people would come to his house, and they'd say, oh, a nice reef. And he'd say, yeah, but what is it, you know? And nobody could figure it out. So, but you need to look at it, and you need to know there's Franklin, and there's a reef. So, which comes up to Aretha Franklin, yes.
Tom's sister Robbie lives in Des Moines, Carolyn in a Minneapolis suburb. They say that memorializing Tom won't be easy, but friends and family members are trying to organize the services the way Tom would have liked it.
His services are going to be happy.
Very happy. Everything we're planning is upbeat, whether it's music or people that want to talk about him or... I mean, it's very tough to be happy now. I mean, we're not happy, but we're trying to make it happy.
Jim Sear, Major 9 News, Sioux City.
The Sioux City community and Siouxland is reacting to many ways to the passing of Tom Peterson. One especially nice tribute is being put together by Avery Brothers Sign Company. As Brian Allen reports, Peterson was a good friend of the Avery family, and the memorial billboard they're creating is a tribute to that friendship.
And I don't think we're going to see another one like him, not in our lifetime.
The painters are hard at work at the Avery Brothers Sign Company, working on a commemorative billboard of their friend Tom Peterson, which will soon be placed on the Gordon Avenue Viaduct. Company co-owner Steve Avery says he and Peterson had been friends for a long time, and that this billboard is a tribute to the way that Peterson lived his life. He lived it for other people.
He was just involved with so many different parts of this city and was so unselfish, and he didn't do it to build his own career. He did it just because that's what he was meant to do. Yeah, he was funny, and he was a great comic and a great mimic and just a natural entertainer. But what he really was a kind heart.
Bill Holbrook is painting this billboard. He agrees with Avery's assessment that there wasn't a member of the Sioux City community that Peterson didn't touch.
He's been in everybody's lives the last 10 or more years, and I've always seen him on TV, and my whole family has too, so they'll touch everybody.
The sign painters here at Avery Brothers say that it will take them close to 7 hours to finish this commemorative billboard for their friend, Tom Peterson. They say they're not doing it for notoriety or to receive any credit. They simply want to remember their friend the way he was, with a smile on his face. Brian Allen, Major 9 News, Sioux City.
The Avery Brothers hope to put that billboard up on the Gordon Drive Viaduct sometime tomorrow, depending on the weather. Well, Tom was the only person killed in that two-vehicle crash that injured 6 other people. Now, 2 of the 6 remain hospitalized and are in stable condition tonight. Ronald Lindemann, his wife Monica, and their 4 sons were in the Chevy Suburban that was hit head-on. Their sons' ages range from 11 to 22. Monica's still in the hospital along with one of her sons. Memorial services for Tom, of course, have been scheduled. We'll give you those again. Family visitation will be held tomorrow evening from 7 to 8:30 at the Sioux City Community Theater. That's on Riverside Boulevard in the western part of Sioux City. A memorial service will be held at 1 o'clock Thursday afternoon at Epley Auditorium. That's on the campus of Morningside College. Both services are open to the public. Our other top story tonight, after more than a year of investigation. People in and around Sioux City and Siouxland continue to pay tribute to KCAU weatherman Tom Peterson, who was killed in a car accident Sunday. Several people have constructed signs and placed them in front of their homes, like this one on 32nd Street. And the Sioux City Community Theater was filled with over 50 floral arrangements today from people who wanted to express their condolences. Peterson was president and general manager of the Sioux City Community Theater. A theater board member spent the day trying to keep up with deliveries of the flowers.
It's really amazing, the generosity and the sympathy coming out to the family and friends. He's going to be missed. He was a wonderful person. And it's coming through in flowers and donations and gifts to the theater.
There will be a visitation tonight at the theater for family members and friends. It begins at 7 o'clock. It ends at 8:30. That's the community theater on Riverside Boulevard in Sioux City. A memorial service for Tom begins at 1 o'clock tomorrow afternoon at Morningside College's Epley Auditorium. That's open to the public. Due to the response of our half-hour tribute to Tom last night, we're going to re-air that program. The half-hour tribute will air this Sunday morning at 11:30 a.m. as part of our Profile 9 segment. Still ahead tonight, Jeff Matthews will rejoin... Siouxland tonight. There was mourning also. Mourners packed Sioux City's community theater this evening for the first public stage of saying goodbye to KCAU veteran weatherman Tom Peterson. Peterson was killed in a head-on car collision in Minnesota Sunday. He was president and general manager of the community theater in addition to his duties here at Channel 9. And as Jim Sear reports, Tom's home away from home was the perfect setting for hundreds of friends to say goodbye.
It was a chance for people whose lives were touched by Peterson to remember Tom in their own way and give their condolences to family members. It was held in Sioux City's community theater, where he spent most of his time when he wasn't telling us about the weather.
It's a time of sorrow, but people are real upbeat. I think people need to be with people right now. They're wandering around, they're enjoying each other. I think it's a living tribute to Tom and how many people his lives affected. And this is their way of saying thanks to him.
By 8 o'clock, community theater members who organized the visitation estimated up to 600 people had passed through the doors, and hundreds more were expected.
The event had only been scheduled until 8:30, but Peterson's sisters said they'd stay here as long as people kept coming.
They also said that they were trying to make his services happy because happiness was what he brought to so many people. The mood for that was set by a string quartet. Tom's friends said that they weren't surprised by the evening's turnout.
He's a well-loved man. You couldn't say anything nice about the guy. I really enjoyed working for him. Had a lot of fun out here with him. He's a real nice guy. He's going to miss him a whole lot.
Those who worked with him at the theater reflected on his tireless support for the stage.
The theater had this raffle where they raffled off a $1,000 bill. Well, I think he sold at least 3,400 or 3,500 tickets just himself. You know, and that's just the way it was. He always had, you know, raffle tickets in his pockets and all, and he would stop everybody. You know, wherever there was a gathering, he would go in and he would sell tickets.
The theater is considering ways to honor Tom's legacy, and that may include naming the theater, his home away from home, after him. Jim Sear, Major 9 News, Sioux City.
A public memorial service for Tom begins at 1 o'clock tomorrow afternoon at Morningside College's Epley Auditorium. Still ahead on our news tonight.
Tom was always open to life, and he was always open to love. He loved life. He loved his family. He loved his friends and his work. But most of all, he just loved people.
A community says goodbye to Siouxland's best friend. Good evening. Thanks for joining us tonight. I'm Greg Lund. Memorial services, actually, were held today for KCAU weatherman and Sioux Cityan Tom Peterson, who died in a car accident Sunday. As in life, Peterson was surrounded by friends from all walks of life today. It was an occasion marked by sorrow, but at the same time, the celebration of his extraordinary life.
Today we must grieve Tom Peterson's death, but we must also celebrate Tom's life. Though our grief is strong and we must mourn, we will not let the shadow of death obscure the living person who touched us many times.
A letter from someone, a small town about 50 miles from Sioux City, wrote, I have a need to share my feelings. I never met Tom in person, but he was always a very welcome guest in my home. He was my weather person. He was kind, calm, and presented the weather with that twinkle in the eye. I never panicked when he gave me weather warnings, just the facts, ma'am, and was able to stay calm and follow his advice. Those summer storms always scared me. My life seems to have always had tension and stress in it. I came home to a renewed appreciation of what I had in Tom being my weather person. You see, he had a calming effect on me at the end of the day, after I dealt with the day's events and even the news of the day, which many times held sad news. This fellow Tom made a real wonderful difference in how I felt, and I will miss him very, very much.
But what you saw on the air from Tom Peterson was the genuine article. I don't believe that I've known somebody who was less pretentious or more common than Pete. But some of the qualities that have already been spoken about Tom's promptness. Every night on the news, the production people can vouch for this. Tom's idea was, why should I go out and sit and wait for the weather to come when I would rather just appear when it's time? Well, he was never out there more than 30 seconds before the weather. And I had my stock line. We're ready for the weather, but Tom's not ready for us. I had to use it twice. But he would come flowing in at about 30 seconds to air. And it's hard for me to describe this, like a ballerina flowing.
But I tell you, every single step of the way has been supported by a note or a phone call from my Uncle Tom saying, hang in there, keep at it, Tony. So I continue to keep at it. And now, unfortunately, the voice is no more.
That's the Mount Zion Church Choir. Tom's spirit touched all those he met and knew in our community. Today, the public who knew Tom and welcomed him into their homes each night said their last goodbyes, just only, though, to his physical presence. The memory of Tom Peterson won't be forgotten. Don Scott has more on the Siouxland community's outpouring of love and support.
Nearly everyone who knew Tom Peterson has a story to tell.
People were saying, don't always take, give a little more. And Tom was one who, I guess, felt strongly that way. And when he was offered a raise by the company, he actually turned it down. He said, I don't need it.
Gibbs says Tom wouldn't accept the money because he said there were others in society who needed that money more than he did. After the memorial service honoring Tom, crowds of friends, family, and even those who didn't know Tom poured out of Epley Auditorium honoring him and remembering the good he brought to the Siouxland community.
You didn't need to know him a long time before he made you feel like you were his best buddy. He had a way of finding whatever he had in common with you. My husband and I have a lot different political leanings from Tom's, and yet we got along so well with him.
Was that he was a people person, and he liked everybody, no matter what their station in life was, and he was very supportive of anyone.
The community painted a picture of their best friend on a billboard and placed it along Gordon Drive.
Tom was always happy.
Life is a stage, and right now he's probably in heaven getting himself an Emmy right about now because he did a neat job, you know.
Like the license plate on his car, the community is certain Tom is now on cloud nine. Don Scott, Major 9 News, Sioux City.
Tom had many close friends, but one Vietnamese man says he owes his life to Tom. Chau Nguyen lived and worked with Tom in the early 1970s during the Vietnam War when Tom was covering the war there. He says they were like brothers. As Laurie Furlong reports, Tom sponsored Chau to become an American citizen and helped him start a new life in the States.
You work together?
Yeah, we're together. We go out and then we help.
Chow Nguyen worked with Tom Peterson for more than a year during the Vietnam War. Tom was a correspondent for the American newspaper Stars and Stripes. Chow worked by Tom's side as his translator. He came back to Sioux City for Tom's memorial service. He said it's a time that he'll never forget.
Every day we have to go out to pick up a news, you know, even in the front line. Even we had the big fighting over there.
We sat down to talk this morning in Tom's house in what he called his Vietnam room. In it, Tom displayed the photos he took, furniture, and other items he brought back from Vietnam. Chow said everyone who met Tom in Vietnam remembered him and his fun-loving personality.
And my kids love him. Anybody over there only saw him, they know him, you know. Even they did say to them much, you know. Everybody like it.
Chow flew back for the service from Sacramento, California, where he now works at a jewelry store. Chow told Tom he wanted to move to the United States 11 years ago, so Tom sponsored him and put him up at his own house and helped him get acquainted with American life.
Come to Sioux City right away. Then Tom had to pay for me the medical checkup and clothing, everything by himself because he my sponsor.
Since then, every summer, Tom flew out to visit Chow in Sacramento. And this summer, they were planning on going back to Vietnam for 3 weeks to see Chow's family and visit the places they had been. Chow said Tom was like a brother to him and said he'll never forget the times they shared.
We get each other every year, you know. We're so happy. We go out. We go to Reno. We go to Lake Tahoe. Everybody like it.
Everybody loves him.
Yeah, love him.
Lori Furlong, Major 9 News, Sioux City.
It's a larger-than-life tribute to Tom Peterson. Avery Brothers Sign Company has painted and put up this billboard that proclaims Tom Peterson as Sioux Land's best friend. Good evening, I'm Larry Wentz. Hundreds of friends and family members said goodbye to longtime KCAU weatherman Tom Peterson this afternoon. A memorial service was held at Epley Auditorium on the Morningside campus for Peterson, who was killed in a car accident Sunday afternoon. It was a final chance to say farewell.
The off-camera Tom Peterson was a complex person whose life was supple and endlessly rich in meaning. But what you saw on the air from Tom Peterson was the genuine article. I don't believe that I've known somebody who was less pretentious or more common than Pete. People often say that accidents like these are a tragedy, and indeed they are. But what I think is a tragedy is if that person's voice is not carried on in the hearts of the people he affected. My uncle's wonderful free spirit and zest for life may be physically gone, but his reaching out to people and living life to the fullest lives on certainly in my heart and in my family's heart and in this community. When asked, how do you see yourself, Tom answered, quote, not very often, and then only in passing. Tom touched our lives in special ways by cheering us up on rainy days. Rainbows of promises he'd lay on the line, now reporting from heaven on his own cloud nine.
Thank you.
Tom Peterson will be missed, but certainly not forgotten by all Siouxlanders.